deserves it. He lives our God, our creator and our keeper. And I don't know about you, I didn't come here today just to be showing up, but to worship God. Give him some praise. Well, we are yet alive. And you can look into each other's face and thank him for his redeeming grace. Amen. Amen. Thank you, choir. Amen. I truly thought about that. I said, well, there's a lot of fans going on in here today. Not as cool as some would like it to be, that we could really go home on that song. And we would not have missed a beat, would we? Amen. Good, thank God. For the choir and the musicians today. They sound good to me. Amen. I thank God for just being God. He did not forsake anybody. He allowed us all to wake up. He didn't stop there, so he allowed us to come to this place called Third Street Bethel, AMEC Church, to give him some praise and some glory in this place. Man, we have not been in here for a while. And it's still not what we want it to be, but we're here. Amen. And we're going to praise and thank today. The word of God today will be taken from the book of Romans, from the 8th chapter. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, that them he also called, and whom he called, them he also justified, and whom he justified, them he also glorified. What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own Son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Amen. Glory to God for the people of God taken from the 8th chapter, second verse. For the sake of preaching today, I would like for you to focus your attention back on that 31st and 32nd verse. If you feel like standing and reading along with me, please feel free to do so. Don't feel like standing and reading because you all have Bibles out and turn to this scripture. Don't trust my reading of it. I could throw anything in there. You need to read it along with me. Preach. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I know somebody thinks I'm going to cut up, but I'm not. What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own Son, but delivered him up for us all. How shall he not with him also freely give him all things? Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, my brothers and sisters, for the reading of that word today. From those words today, I stop by here to really ask you a question. When will we learn? If God be for us, who can be against us? When will we learn? Let us pray. Eternal God, our Heavenly Father, humbly I come in the name of your Son, Jesus. Very thankful for this another opportunity that you have given me a chance to stand in this sacred spot. You didn't have to do it, but you did, and I thank you for that. You didn't have to bring any of us in here today, but you did, God, and I thank you for that. Thank you for those that have taken time to visit with us today. Thank you, oh Heavenly Father, for watching over us the past weekend, allowing us to come. Thank you for the love of your Son, Jesus, and your sweet, sweet Holy Spirit.
Yeah, Lord.
Thank you for this moment, God, of your past, now that you use this preaching. Preach through this preacher today that your word will go forth and enter the ears of a dying generation and tell some soul today what thus saith the Lord. In Jesus' name I ask this. Say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I read an article written by Reverend Charles Adams, whereas he was talking about something called a teachable moment. He was saying that a teachable moment is the time when God gets our undivided attention. A time when people are willing to listen to God. A time when they are willing to listen to God's word and not to all the idiotic stuff that surfaces in their mind. A time when you have your focus on nothing else but what God is saying to you. I concur with the preacher, for I also believe that the reason the word of God doesn't seem to have an effect upon some people's lives are, have not changed their lives, stem from the fact that God has not gotten their undivided attention. God has not been able to speak to them through the preacher or anybody else, because they are all too focused on self and the world around them. In order for God to change, to comfort and direct you, you must be willing to hear from him. Can I get a witness in here? All too many times I've heard people say that I want to change my life, but they try to accomplish that change without listening to God. That's why their change never looks like change. You know, my brothers and sisters, it's sad to say, but most of us didn't want to hear God until after everything had gone wrong and our lives had begun to fall apart. Maybe not y'all with me. Wouldn't we know that we had life under control and the pleasures of the world had our attention? God couldn't get our attention until that life began to unravel around us. I want somebody to listen to me today. You may have looked at me. You may have smiled with me. Listen to me today. I will tell you this. God knows how to get your attention. Look at what happened after that memorable day of September 11, 2001. I'll never forget. People came flocking to the churches ready to hear a word from God. God got our attention, and they wanted and needed to hear from the Lord. God cannot mold or shape us into what we ought to be, nor can he direct us or help us until he gets our undivided attention. I wish somebody would say undivided attention. See, because somebody's not listening to me already. A time when we are willing to hear from God and from God alone. There's a story about a man who had a stubborn and an uncooperative mule. Now, if you're not a country boy like myself, you might not know anything about this kind of a mule. He was stubborn and uncooperative, and he couldn't do anything. The farmer couldn't do anything with the mule. So the mule's owner sent for a mule trainer. that had a reputation for training stubborn mules. The story said that when fetching a mule trainer arrived, he took off his coat, rolled up his shirt sleeves, and picked up a 2x4 plank and began to beat the mule merciless. And after several hard blows to the mule's head, to his neck and his back, the mule began to stagger. The mule's owner got upset with the trainer and said, I wanted you to train my mule, not kill him. The trainer answered and said, I am going to train him. But first I've got to get his undivided attention. I've got to get him into a teachable mode.
I wonder if anybody knows what I'm talking about.
My brothers and sisters, just like the mule, God will not get some people's attention until their life slaps them around and beats them into a teachable mood. A time when God will have their undivided attention. There's probably someone in here today that would not have given God his or her undivided attention, nor you have been open to hear what thus saith the Lord, if life had not whipped you down. Isn't it sad that something tragic is going to have to happen before some people will give God their undivided attention? Isn't it sad that some people will have to lose something dear to them before God can get their attention? You know what I'm talking about? There's probably somebody in here that's going through something and you've been crying, why, Lord, have you let this happen to me? Maybe it's happened because God has not been able to get your attention. God has not been able to get you into a teachable mode. Our scripture today is one that you'll have to be in a teachable mode in order to experience what Paul is saying when he says, if God be for us, who can be against us? In other words, you got to reach a point in your life when you're willing to hear this word and believe that no matter what's going on around you or what's happening to you, God is for you and not against you. I do wonder, what is it going to take before some of us learn that God is real and not just some imaginary thing? That God is not far away, but he walks right by our side. What is it going to take before God can get some people's undivided attention, Third Street? Your attention when you're ready to come in here and hear what the preacher has to say and not stare at the windows or at the ceiling or talking to somebody all around you. When will God get your attention? My brothers and sisters, in times like this, and I'm not going to keep you long today, God ought to have our undivided attention. In times like these, when this world seems to be falling apart, troubles all around us, and the world is sweltering with racism and terrorism, God ought to have our undivided attention. In times like these, when there are so many problems to be solved, so many questions to be answered, when the politics of our country is fueled by greed, bigotry, and hatred instead of love and humanity. Lord, humanity. In times like these, when our adequate paying good jobs are disappearing, and people are sick or dying because health care is out of their reach, is the time that we ought to be in a teachable mode. A mode to grasp what Paul is saying when he says, if God be for us, who can be against us? We read that sometimes. We read about all we do. But do you believe it? I'm sure that there's somebody in here today that's a little confused by what Paul is saying. Because you're interpreting it to mean that if God is for you, you won't have any enemies. I got news for you. It's puzzling to you because when you look around your life, you'll find that the enemy has already shown up. And Paul is still saying, if God is for you, who can be against you. The way people have talked about you, huh? Taken from you, abused you, raped you, denied you a third chance. And Paul is still saying, if God is for you, who can be against you? Now someone might be asking, what qualifies Paul to teach us? Well, first of all, Paul was not insinuating that if God is for you, you're not going to have any enemies. Paul was a man of God, yet he was no stranger to troubles. Nor was he without enemies. Let's look at some of the stuff that Paul had to endure. Acts 14:19 says that one time the Jews stoned Paul. Drug him outside of the city and left him for dead. Yet the Bible says that when his disciples surrounded him, God lifted Paul up. And Paul went right back into the city. Well, I stop by here to ask you, is there anybody in a teachable mode? Have you learned that when your enemy thinks he's got the best of you, it's not over until God says it's over? Paul went back into the city and stayed for one day, just long enough for the enemy to see that God had kept him in the midst of it all. Oh yeah, I can imagine that he said, you tried to kill me, but God kept me alive. Oh, somebody knows what I'm talking about. For there was a time when the enemy tried to do you in. But you were still here because God kept you. If God is for you, who can be against you? Well, 2 Corinthians said that after Paul had a vision of what paradise looked like, along came a messenger of Satan and became a thorn in Paul's side. How many of you know that when the spirit is high, you're feeling good about your journey to heaven? That's when the devil will show up, huh? You know what I'm talking about. Have you ever left church feeling good? High on the spirit. And the devil crosses your path before you get out of church. Well, it says that Paul prayed three times, asking the Lord to move the thorn out of his side. And the Lord didn't remove the thorn, but he did answer Paul. What did he say to Paul? My grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. In essence, Jesus was saying, though you have that thorn, I don't have to move it, but I'm going to give you power. Power to bear up under that thorn. The question for somebody is, when will you learn that God may not always move the troubles out of your way, but he can surely give you what you need to bear your burden? God can give you power to hold out to the race in one. You see, sometimes God wants you to stand fast in the midst of what the enemy is throwing at you. So that when the enemy sees you standing in the midst of all that he's throwing at you, he'll know that it is the power of God that's keeping you. That's why 2 Corinthians says, my power is made perfect in your weakness. I used to wonder how in the world did the old grandmothers and single mothers raise their children. Hey, back then you hear stories how they raise the kids and work day in and day out at the same time, but yet they gave God the praise. Why? Because they understood that if God is for you, who can be against you? No matter what you're going through, God will. Thank you, Lord. I need to hear that today. In the world, you're going to have mountains that you can't move and problems you can't solve. You're going to have some up and you're down. You're going to have some success and some failures in this life. Whether it's mountains to move, problems to solve, burdens to bear, or failures to face, Paul is teaching us. The ones of us that's in a teaching mode, the ones of us that can hear the word and trust the word, those that are ready to hear from the Lord, that through it all, God than any enemy that you face. If God be for you, who can be against you? God's not going to let those that love him be permanently overcome by the enemy. I believe that. For this would disrupt God's whole plan of salvation. God desired that his children have a chance at salvation, and nothing can change that plan. Nothing can get in the way. According to the 29th 30th verses, this plan has been predestined. In other words, God has set up his plan for salvation before we ever knew anything about salvation. He predetermined that those that want to be saved can be saved, and no devil can stop it from happening. God is sovereign and in control. I wonder if I have anybody in here today that wants to be saved and you didn't know that you could be, but you can be. In order to make this story short, because I know it's warm in here, Paul is saying in the 29th through the 30th verses that the plan of salvation was predetermined by God. And if you accept that plan of salvation through Jesus, then the word says that you will be justified, are declared righteous through Jesus, and God will glorify you with a glorious home in his eternal kingdom. And God will protect those that he has elected into his eternal family. On your way to that eternal kingdom, you're going to be trapped.
Do you know what I'm talking about?
On your way to heaven, you're going to be tempted. On your way to heaven, you're going to face some storms. You're going to run into some detours. But do you think that God would prepare a crown and a kingdom for us and not give us enough power to bear, to make it there? But Paul said, what shall we say to those things that God has put in place for salvation? He is simply saying, what conclusion can we draw from what God has already laid out in his plan to save us? What comfort may we derive from God's doctrine of salvation? If God be for us, who can be against us? In other words, if God, who is infinitely wise, has undertaken to direct us, if God, who is all-powerful, has undertaken to protect us, if God, who is infinitely good, has undertaken to save us, then what cunning devil, be it Trump or whoever you want to call it, what evil being or what malice is there that can prevail against God's wisdom, his power, and his goodness? Even when you feel that you've been kicked to the curb, stepped on, abused, disrespected, or falsely accused, if God be for you, who can be against you? I'm glad that I'm talking to a whole lot of people today that didn't know anything about being kicked to the curb. Doesn't know anything. Abused or falsely accused. Because I have to believe that if you were in here, I'd hear somebody say, amen, preacher. Well, I don't mean if I've never been down, I wouldn't say anything either. But I've been way down. And I've been for the Lord. I've been for the Lord. So I know if God be for me, in the 31st verse is really a slap in the devil's face. It's the challenge to the enemies of God's children. Paul used this rhetorical question actually to make a statement. For I believe Paul knew that the devil as well as God's children should know the answer to the question. It was just Paul's way of saying, Satan, though you might be strong and you have many followers, though you throw all kinds of mess at God's children, you will not and cannot prevail. For when God is for them, he's more than you will ever be against them. Somebody ought to shout on that, bro. So I wonder, when will God's children learn that when God is for us, when God is on your side, you're more than a conqueror? When will God's children learn that when God is on your side, He's more than enough. I don't know when you learned it, but I have to believe that if the church in general understood that, the pews would be empty because your feet would be on the floor and you would be standing to praise the Lord. Because you know that if God is for you, I don't care what that old spouse does or say. I don't care what the enemy does. If God is for you, God will pull you through. How can church people sit so still? What the doctor says. If you learn to trust in that word, trust in God. Don't just go around talking that good stuff. I trust in the Lord. No doggone well, every time a storm hit, you cave in. But trusting in God means that you'll stand in the midst of your sickness. You'll stand in the midst of difficult situations and trust Him. When will God's children learn that when God is for us, when God is on your side, you're more than a conqueror? When will God's children stop just coming to church just to come? Leave. When they leave, because they the word in the pew, they don't trust the word. I don't know what the old preacher said. That's why some can be so quiet in the church. Because they don't really believe it. But I stop right here to tell you, whether you believe it or not, the God we serve is bigger than anything that you face. Somebody ought to praise Him because He lifted you up. Tell you this day, He didn't have to bring you here, but He did. When will God's people learn that when God is on your side, He's more than enough? Some people can't seem to get enough. They're always reaching for more and more. But I stop by here to tell you that when you really get God, you'll have enough. You'll have enough to see you through. You'll have enough to pay your bills. You'll have enough to meet the enemy. You'll have enough to lift you out of the world of the place in your life. You'll have enough. God is on your side. He's a friend above all friends. He bred in a starving land and hope in a bad situation. When God is on not the preacher, but when God is on your side, He's fighting for you. When the enemy is fighting against you, I'm going to let you go. I'm going to hold you for a few more minutes. People in a teachable moment right now. Oh, I don't know about you, but I'm glad that I serve a God like that. One that's greater than my enemy. One that's sparing nothing for me. For the 32nd verse said that He even gave up His own Son for us. And through that Son, He freely gives us all things. And when you get right down to it, this holy chapter is all about God's plan to save us. It's a reminder of all that God has already done through Jesus, through the sacrificial blood of Jesus. Your way up, your way out has already been perfected. Your victory has already been solidified. And your salvation is guaranteed. All ask the question, if God is for you, then who can be against you? He's simply asking us to remember that the love and power that's found in the saving grace of Jesus.
Yeah.
Remember what my son has already done for you. Yeah. Remember how he got up out of the grave. Yeah. Remember how they stretched him wide on the cross for you and for me. Remember, he's already done more for you than we're willing to do for ourselves.
Yeah.
And so remember that God is for you.
Yeah.
Who can be against you? How many of you have learned enough about Jesus? How many of you have learned enough about Jesus that you can walk down into somebody's sick room with your healing and say, I know that if God is for you, he's more than the sickness against you. How many of you have been blessed enough by Jesus that you can speak into somebody's trouble situation? Maybe they're sitting right by your side right now and tell them that if God is for you, he's more the troubles against you. I wish I could get the church to say right now, if God before you, he's more than the enemy against you. Yeah. Is there anybody in here that has learned enough about Jesus that you can take your fixed up life and walk into somebody's broken life and tell them if God is for you, he's more than the brokenness in your life. See, that's what we're called to be as believers. We ought to be able to convince somebody. But the goodness of God, what you can't do it if you walk around complaining and grumbling every time that God gives you a breath to do so. You can't do it. You walk around with your head all hung down. You can't do it, but let you believe it. And if you believe it, I declare, I believe you will tell somebody else that I know Jesus. They tell me he's from Galilee. Oh, they crucified him. But he got up on the third day. In other words, instead of complaining about how bad things are, is there anybody willing to talk about how Jesus has blessed you? Is there anybody willing to tell somebody, I gotta trust him, and I really respect him. He's not here today. But I never been complaining. Even complaining about what's going wrong at the church. He seemed to take it and move on. I know he called his name today, but he's not here. But I respect him because he doesn't walk around complaining and grumbling. He see when something needs to be done and he get it done. That's somebody that God is for you. Who can be against you? So sometimes I have to learn from my own members, but I'm not gonna learn from you. I'm gonna only pick up some good stuff that helps me. In other words, instead of complaining about how bad things are, is there anybody willing to talk about how Jesus blessed you? Huh? Is there anybody willing to tell somebody, if you so look at your neighbor and say, if God is for you, who can be against you? I bet you somebody didn't even look at their neighbors, but that's all right. I'm looking at all of them. If God is for you, who can be against you? If there's one in here today that has not heard nor believed this word from God, what is it going to take for you? What is it going to take to wake you up? What is it going to take for you to learn that if God is for you, he's more than the enemy against you? And I declare, if you know that, you're going to stomp your feet. At least smile. You don't have to get up and act. But though you know something, that's good, when we know something that's good. When something good to us, we cut up. Everybody around us know it's good. If I tell everybody, see you good, I'm going to stay right there. Please, my brothers and sisters, prepare yourself for the Lord's Supper and prepare to serve.